Ooh. Welcome to the video. Now, I didn't tape last night because we did watch the NBA Finals Warriors, our home team, win the championship. And people are asking, you know, how can anyone beat the Warriors? They're such a juggernaut, right? And they are. And we're kind of almost embarrassed about it. Anyway, how can you beat the Warriors? And the Cavaliers are the only team that can really beat them. And the answer is pretty simple. I came up with it today. It's very simple. They have to gain home court advantage, which means they have to win the most games during the regular season. If they can do that, I think that would tip the balance pretty strongly, actually, if they had home court advantage. So it's not insurmountable obstacle, actually. And we can apply that to this world. How can we win the battle here in this world? And what is the battle? We know what the battle is, actually. Without getting into that right this moment, we will say that we need home court advantage. We need home court advantage. Well, what is home court advantage for us? It's a good question. It's worth considering. Is this the only home we have, this world? Is this really our home? Are we playing a game on a hostile court, so to speak, right? With everybody booing us and yelling at, you know, the Golden State Warriors had a great advantage last night playing at home. I mean, the crowd was just, you know, lifting the roof off of the place. It was just extraordinary. And you could feel the energy. At one point in the game, they were losing, and then one of their players did this tremendous drive and slam dunk. And where we were, everybody was just shouting, and you could feel the energy just shift suddenly. And in the auditorium, the court where they were playing, Oracle Arena in Oakland, everyone just suddenly felt like, here we go, like that. Here we go. And from then on, they were unbeatable. They were losing up to that point, but something turned the tide. A very dramatic play, with emphasis, just saying, you know, exerting their authority over their court, so to speak. So this is our court, you know, this is our home. You're not going to win here, and the change was very palpable. It was an extraordinary moment, and a lot of people said the same thing, that they felt that it was a shift. They said, It's just shifted suddenly. So, home court advantage is very important. Very, very important. The energy and the support for your home team is extraordinary. So who's the home team in this world? It's certainly not us, really, right? We're playing on the road here in a very hostile environment. But if we could get home court advantage, it would be a whole different story. If we could be supported by our home, and feel supported by that, it could be a very different outcome here. So we are getting help, but it still feels like, I certainly feel, we went into diagnostic and center, like it's like a hospital center, just to do massive amount of diagnostics there. And I just, you know, realize, it just, every time I go into, have anything to do with the healthcare system, I can just feel it. I can feel the drastic difference between me and the world. Drastic difference. And, you know, this is, I was saying, like, I don't have any value at all. I can't even get sick. You know, what do people value? They value sickness. They absolutely do. They value sickness. I can't even get sick. You know, I can't do anything. Okay, so I can't do anything at all. I can't even get sick. I can't even die. I can't even get sick. I can't even get well. But that's the feeling I've had in my life. Is like, what an outcast. You know, I can't even get sick. So I certainly tried my best to get sick, and I managed, but deep down, I really know that I can't really get sick. It's impossible. But you feel like an alien here, actually, because this world is really about sickness. If you examine it carefully, it's about sickness. I was thinking last night of doing a comedy routine. I think there's some I saw on my looked at my email or something online, and there was an advertisement for a new show, something like "I'm Dying Up Here." It's a comedy show. I think Jim Carrey is producing it, the great Canadian comedian. And I imagine myself that I went up to the chair on stage, and I'm going to be the comedian. And I started talking to the audience, and I started talking about death. And I said, "Look, I'm dying up here." I said, "But I'm not the only one who's dying. You're going to die along with me, because every single one of you is, this very moment, is dying. You're all dying. The clock is ticking on your death. One more second has passed away till you die." So I was just really hitting the audience. I said, "Okay, you're not going to laugh at my humor. So I'm going to die, but you're going to die with me. I'm going to see to it that you're just as nervous as I am giving the comedy routine." And in doing that, it was amazing to explore the fact, as you look at this world, you realize we're all dying. Everything is dying. And sort of brought it in to highlight, and why do we seek comedy? And we try to escape this. We try to block this out. Like, "Oh my gosh, I'm one step closer to dying." Even if you're 90, I met a friend today, 90 years old, hadn't seen him in a while, and he's still chipper as can be. He's slowed down, his walking is a lot slower, but he's very lucid in his mind and quick. But he says, "I can't go anywhere anymore. I'm kind of anchored to where I am. That's it. I'm just anchored here." The clock is ticking on him. Even at 90, he's lived a long time, but it's ticking on him. It's ticking on everyone. But we're uncomfortable, even thinking about this. But if we work on devaluing the I, funny thing is, we begin to say, "Wait a minute, I can't even die. I can't do anything. I'm not able to do anything at all. I can't even die," which is sacrilege to this world, right? The whole world is all about dying. That's all that it is. It's really about dying, which is trying the attempt to induce abnormality. You might say, trying to induce the presence of no presence. Kind of weird, isn't it? Try to induce the presence of no presence. And so the way that we have ultimately come up with this notion of dying, it as an inducement technique to try to induce abnormality from reality, an absence of reality. We want the presence of the absence of reality. We want to experience that. So we want to experience the absence of reality, actually. And so we imagine that dying is very attractive to this hope for absence of reality, because we're saying, "Well, here's life," and we claim it's reality. Here's life, and now there's an absence of life. You see, it's disappearing, and ultimately will be gone. So surely we say, you can't resist all the dying that's taking place in this world, and we think that this world is really a very hopeful place to induce the absence of intrinsicness, absence of reality. And so what we do is we come here to sacrifice. To take part in this global sacrifice. It's continual. This world's a continual global sacrifice. That's what it really is, in terms of our purpose for it. What it really is intrinsicness along with everything else. There's only intrinsicness. So nothing is absent from intrinsicness. Life and death, it's the same in intrinsicness. All is the same in terms of being intrinsic. There's nothing non-intrinsic at all. Everything is, where's everything? In intrinsic spaciousness, it's all is this intrinsicness. And so the world is attempting, this place that we come to try to induce the absence of intrinsicness. And the Dharma kings, the ones who have come to this world to inform us about this and help us get free of it, this is the Dharma in this world, which is turning us away from this insane attempt to experience the absence of intrinsicness. They have brought a lot of help to us. Okay, but right now, there's been, you might say, a backlash to all that help. We kind of got cold feet, and we thought, hey, wait a minute, maybe we can stop this dying. We can get free of this dying. We don't need this. And then we said, whoa, that I don't know what to expect. If we do that, we don't know what to expect. And so we had a loss of confidence, a loss of momentum here in this world. And sort of to fill that vacuum in, we turned back towards dying again. And in order to keep this ridiculous attempt to induce the absence of intrinsic space, intrinsicness, the presence of the absence of intrinsicness, which is absurd, we need to keep on believing in dying. Okay? How do we do that? Because we really aren't the body at all. We're spirit. Well, we do it by believing that we're the body, that we're a creature. So what happens is when we lose our nerve on the spiritual path towards a awakening, recognition that it's impossible to induce the absence of intrinsicness, we believe we're creatures, and we believe that the brain is the mind, and we believe that we have, you know, that we get sick and we get ill and we die, and we believe that whatever suffering we're suffering is traceable to brain abnormality or physical abnormality or something like that, instead of the mind and the desire and purpose of the mind. And so we ignore the true purpose and causation of this world, which is the mind, the desire of mind, spirit, mind to induce the absence of reality and experience that as if it were a new creation. We ignore that. We ignore the Dharma. And when we ignore the Dharma in terms of getting free of suffering, well, and we believe we're creatures, that we start suffering a lot worse, because that reinforces our belief in inducing the absence of intrinsicness is suffering, illness. We think that this is attractive. Something abnormal is very attractive to abnormal reality, right? We reason. Our logic is like that. So we don't really want to be too healthy, or you know, or mentally healthy. We actually, the way what happens is we become very mentally ill, which causes physical illness, brings about physical maladies of all different types, and then we insist on treating all of that in a materialistic, behavioralistic way through drugs, chemicals, pharmaceuticals, and surgeries, and all these various physical means, instead of treating our suffering through spiritual practice, meaning mental approach. This is what happens. So this has been going on for a long time. There's a study done back in, was it the late 1970s or 1980s, on opioid use, prescribing opioids for hospital patients, and it wasn't a study, it was like one paragraph, and it basically was a very questionable and flawed study that really was not a study hardly at all, and it got cited over and over and over and over and over throughout the years, and exaggerated and referenced without checking in on it, and ultimately it created this sort of a great push and rationale for prescribing opioids outside of the hospital. You didn't used to be able to take you know, opioid narcotics home with you. If you're in really severe pain, they might prescribe in the hospital, but once you left the hospital, you couldn't have those. They were felt to be very addictive and very dangerous. But this one paragraph in a journal, repeated endlessly, kind of like, you know, someone posts something on the internet and everyone copies and pastes it, and it becomes like a social myth, right? This is what happened. The social myth actually evolved to the idea that it was safe to prescribe opioids outside of the hospital to outpatients, etc. And now there's vast numbers of people using opioids outside of the context of a hospital and severe pain and a doctor's close supervision. And last year in the United States, 59,000 people died with overdoses. Most of those probably would be opioid overdoses of painkillers. 59,000 in 1 year. It's an incredible problem in the world. All traced back to this super flawed one paragraph kind of blurb. And there was talk and is talk, and back in the day there was talk. One of the theories is that this was a conspiracy by the pharmaceutical executives to get this information and promote it, promote it, promote it, cite it, cite it, cite it like that. Very bad science. Wouldn't be surprising, huh? Because the will of the world now is to try to keep promoting the inducement of abnormal reality. That's they've gone. The world's gone back to this. There's nowhere else to go. I mean, you go to the Dharma, or you go back to trying to induce abnormality. And the centerpiece of all this is a medical healthcare system. How you view your health, how you view your health, is at the center of it all. So we have in 1975-ish, A Course in Miracles began to be disseminated among people, and this was the work of Jesus collaborating with a few of us here in this world, writing down what his prescription for us all, which he said, all trouble is in the mind. It never leaves the mind. The body is neutral. It's neither well nor sick of itself at all. All suffering, all sickness is totally come in comes from the mind and never leaves the mind, actually. And so all treatment has to be mental treatment. It has to be mental treatment. He said we're insane. We're mentally ill, and more than we realize, and we have to turn this around. So, and Jesus continues with this. Continue with it with Journey Beyond Words, Dialogue on Awakening. It's his perspective is the perspective that I agree with, and always has subscribed to. That everything we're experiencing is a mental projection. I call it, it's a pretense. We're pretending. We're pretending to be sick. Okay, where does the pretending come from? Does the body pretending? No. Is a puppet pretend to be sick? Or just the puppeteer? Is it the puppeteer that's causing the puppet to, oh, I'm so sick, you know? And yeah, which is it? Yeah. Some people say, well, it's both. Really? Just consider that for a minute here. All right. So you're either going to view it one way or the other. You say it's some both, and that's the most insidious of all. And there's been a lot of attempts in this world to hide the fact that we've gone away from truth by claiming, well, it's part mind, part body, that kind of ideology. And this has really muddied the waters. Jesus says it's all mind. Okay, the body plays no role in sickness whatsoever. It's like a mirror. It's like blaming, saying what's in the mirror is part, you know, part mirror, part. Well, if the mirror's not reflecting properly, but Jesus says the body does reflect perfectly what the mind purpose that the mind has for it. And I believe this, no matter what the reasoning and experience that I've had is such that I absolutely go along with this, that the body is not causative at all. It's like an effect. It accurately reflects what's the purpose of the mind. So the world's barking up the wrong tree. And you can feel it. I just feel like I'm so out of place. I say all these people. I was thinking like everyone has smartphones, and I was thinking like, well, I'm not bourgeois enough to have a smartphone. What are you talking about? Everyone wants to be the bourgeois, right? Bourgeoisie. I got a smartphone. I'm equal now to the bourgeois. But who am I kidding? I'm not equal. I'm not bourgeois. So who am I to have a smartphone? I can't even get sick. I mean, I'm this class of really mental health experts, and we're really not really even allowed to get sick. Really not even allowed to die. And so we can't use a smartphone. Why not? Because the smartphone, I was telling somebody that really everything you get in popular culture, common culture, smartphone, internet, movies, entertainment, television, newspapers, magazines, books, classrooms, news. I mean, it's all encompassing, really. Attitudes is really the content which reflects the purpose, that belief that sickness comes from the body and we have to treat it, therefore, with physical substances. So it's really comes from the pharmaceutical industry and the healthcare industry. They actually are the ones that have really had the money and the desire and purpose to design modern culture, and they have. They absolutely have. And I tell people, if you're on your smartphone, you are being brainwashed by pharmaceutical interests. You most certainly are. And if you pay any attention to this culture, you are being brainwashed, severely brainwashed. That's your purpose. If you've lost your nerve on the path, spiritual path, then that's what you want. You want to be brainwashed. And so they're just doing what you want them to do, which is severe job of brainwashing you, thinking that your troubles come from the brain and the body and therefore need to be treated with drugs. So Jesus has the opposite standpoint. The opposite standpoint. Okay, and he insists that there's no middle ground between the two. He insists it's one or the other. You can't have it both ways. You can't have reality as both normal and abnormal. You can't have presence as everywhere and absent somewhere. He said that's complete absurdity. That is not love. He said love is all inclusive. It doesn't create and leave out something from love, then it wouldn't be love. So he really harps on this constantly, and we need that harping from him. Otherwise, we would probably be doomed to this sort of hybridization belief system, which is then really produces severe mental illness, where you're both physically ill and mentally ill. This is what happened. This is what I experienced in this world as this hybridization belief system of the pharmaceutical industry basically said to those who are spiritually motivated, say, oh, okay, we'll make a deal with you. It'll be, part body, part mind. And that's all we had to go on, pretty much in my day, although Christian scientists, which I was basically adhered to that belief, Christian science is, we said, no, it's all the mind. But they put so much pressure through culture that eventually we started thinking, well, maybe there's some integral sort of combination. And I fought against it, but it affected me to the extent then I got physically ill and mentally ill, both, which is the worst. At least all these people just they think they're physically ill. I mean, they just go to the doctor, they take drugs, they get surgery, and they just it's their lifestyle. It's a lifestyle here. The healthcare system is a lifestyle for most people here. It's amazing what you see. And they don't think about it or bother about it at all. And they're not really mentally troubled, too troubled, about it. Their mental illness is such that it's simply believing that they can kick it down the road and it'll be fine. Whereas if you're trying to believe that it's caused both by the body and the mind, you're in tremendous conflict. And you're trying to please two sides that are incompatible with one another. And this gives an acute conflict. So we absolutely don't want to go there, having experienced that to the nth degree in my life. What's vitally important is you really have to understand and have it repeated and share it over and over. It's totally the mind. It's 100%. All pretense comes from the pretender. Okay, it doesn't come from the pretense, so to speak. The appearance of the pretense. It's like someone pretending to be crippled. Are they actually crippled and not crippled? So yeah, they're pretending to be crippled, but they're also crippled. I mean, to accept that is to believe in absurdity, right? It's each one contradicts the other. Either, you know, if they're crippled, they're crippled. If they're not, if they're pretending and they're not crippled but pretending, then they're pretending. And yet this is so difficult for all of us to accept this. We think, no, there must be some exceptions. You know, there has to be. But that's the brainwashing that we get here. So we're in a hostile territory in this world. This is what I'm very able, easily to see, I've always seen. This world is supremely hostile towards the notion that it's all the mind. Okay, they're willing to say, well, maybe it's partly the mind. And they think they're being very accommodating by that. So spirituality is really promoted by the pharmaceutical companies in this world through their really advertising and they have amazing control of the content that you see, but very sort of a hidden hand. They know that to promote mental illness is their ticket to ongoing profit, because if you start to get mental health, you won't take drugs anymore. Basically, you'll be weaned off of them at some point. And you won't go back. You won't go back. Now, I mean, if there's something that I still have a trouble with, and I have to take something, yeah, I'll probably take it. If I have to. But right now, I'm not taking anything, and for almost all of my life, I've not taken anything. When I was really ill with both mental and physical illness, I tried taking certain antidepressants, and they made things much worse. And so I stopped anti-anxiety. I stopped. I said, wow, this isn't the way at all. And then I started with A Course in Miracles. I said, this is it. And from that point on, I've never touched a single medication except when I had a tooth extracted for the pain. And so that's it. So the world would be a very different place. And the entertainment, our culture would be very, very different. Because it would not be controlled by the money of the pharmaceutical companies. They wouldn't have any money to spend. And we would control our culture based on mental health. And our culture would help us towards mental health. Right now, our culture is helping us towards mental illness to an absolutely unprecedented degree. It's so unprecedented, you can't even compare. You cannot compare previous eras, etc., because of technology, social media, the news, how everything is amplified to the nth degree and spread throughout the world instantly, and you know, it's so incredibly different than it used to be here. So a mouse has more power now in the world than a mighty elephant in the past, right? So the capacity to spread mental illness here is unprecedented, and that's exactly what's happening, actually. Is people are simply believing that mental illness is, you know, the right thing to do, because that will induce, they believe, will induce the absence of reality. And this is the goal that spirit has. It wants to be really greater than God. It wants to be able to say, I changed reality. Reality is now the way I want it to be. It's different. And I had the power to change the will of God. That's ultimately what it's about. So how do you defeat this monster, you know, in the world? And this is a question. Now, Jesus just tells us to do this practice, advanced practice of devaluing the I. He says you can defeat it this way in your own mind. Okay, but can we turn the world around, you know, the situation around? Because it's unprecedented what's happening here. It's nothing like it used to be. It used to be that people didn't feel so empowered towards mental illness as they are now. And so they were a little bit hesitant to, you know, they would listen to spirituality. By the way, again, spirituality is sponsored by the pharmaceutical industry, and the conglomerate, the global healthcare conglomerate, sponsors what's called spirituality, which is how to sort of gloss, the lip gloss of believing that you're a creature. It's a way to accommodate the truth of what you are as just an accessory kind of lip gloss to the belief that you're abnormal, you're a creature, and that your illness comes from the body and physical causes. And so a lot of people in the world have a spirituality, so to speak. They've got but that's really nothing to do with truth. It's really nothing to do. It's a way of sort of helping you ignore the heart of the teaching. It is to look at, sort of pay attention to the bells and whistles. You know, pay attention to the bells and whistles and avoid the heart of it, which is, you know, where does suffering come, you know, what's causing the suffering? Right? So, bells and whistles, that's all it is. Spirituality, here we go. So we live in a fidget spinner. We live in a fidget spinner world, don't we? Yeah. And everybody is fidgety and sick. And, you know, they're diagnosing everybody even before they're born. They say, okay, well, your baby's got all this and this and this and this, and you'll need to get them started on drugs right away. Really? They're looking at the genome sequence stuff, and they say, okay, we know exactly that the illnesses your child has, physical problems, the genetic problems, so we're going to, maybe they'll start treating it in the womb pretty soon, actually, before the child is born. And when the child's born, the shots that people have to take now is unbelievable. And if you're trying to get a citizen in the United States, for instance, you have to go through so many, many, many vaccines and shots. And so the kids are now they're all sick. They're told you're all ill, you're all sick, physically ill, and here's all the drugs to treat that. And so they get them hooked on the notion of taking drugs from the moment they're born, basically. And I hardly ever took anything. My parents, especially my dad, he didn't want us to take anything. He was raised like a Christian Scientist, strongly so. And he said, look, it's the power of the mind. Use your mind, mind over matter. You'll get well, don't worry. Just keep your confidence, you know. And he didn't, you know, so there's elements of Christian Science in it. Absolutely, there was a lot. And so he was very, very, very strict about it, whether we took anything. Our shots, I think I maybe had one shot in my life. Even if, I don't even know if I had one inoculation or shots or anything. He said, no, that stuff's not good for you. It's not right. It gives you the wrong mental focus, etc. And he was absolutely right. Today, these days, though, I mean, you can hardly function in culture at all if you're a younger person growing up, if you don't have all the shots. You can't even go to school. And they're finding more and more and more illnesses. You go, you got to have this, you got to have this, you got to have this, you got to have this. And all this, you know, is just, of course, causing everyone to become more and more mentally ill. And which, of course, they treat that too. They say, don't worry, we have all this mental illness. And of course, that makes you fall asleep and crash your car. So, well, you know, be more, a little more careful. And so they always have more drugs to treat the problems that the previous drugs are causing. And it's sort of a black hole that we're going down to. As we become more and more mentally ill with false belief. And the notion that, well, the best we can do is to have both. It's caused both by the body and by the mind. The mind might cause a little bit of it, but the body's, you know, causing a lot of it. And then accommodate that with spirituality. Sort of work a little bit of spirituality in there, right? A little seasoning, salt, you know, a little seasoning on your food. The false food, false belief. And then we kind of feel like, well, I'm paying a little bit of, you know, homage to spirituality, spirit. At least I mention it a little occasionally, maybe. A little tip of the hat occasionally. You know, sort of tokenism. It's kind of tokenism. Spirituality is tokenism, actually. Very much tokenism. Yeah, we got the minority at the country club. At least we had one back, you know, a couple of years ago. And we're fine. We're fully integrated. No problems here. Just to use a crass example, not to pick on country clubs, but so it's from my standpoint, you know, it's a dire situation because you look at the you hear the people say we're about ready to all awaken. And say, really? To awaken, you have to understand that this is all 100% pretense. It's all make believe. It's a dream. All suffering is pretending. It's a pretending in order to try to induce what can never be induced, which is an absence of reality, an absence of intrinsicness. Reality, the nature of reality is it's everywhere. It's omnipresent, equally omnipresent everywhere. And it's like intrinsic spaciousness. You know, where is there anything that's not abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness? And intrinsic spaciousness is all smooth. Therefore, everything is this smooth continuum of intrinsic spaciousness. There's no place where there's more or less of it. And how could there be an absence of intrinsic spaciousness and still have something, some presence? There can't be. It's completely absurd. You know, just like this fidget spinner. I mean, you know, you spin it. I mean, it's still in what? In spaciousness, right? It is occupying spaciousness, and every it itself is part of the spaciousness. It's one with the spaciousness. Everything is one with the intrinsic spaciousness. And so you cannot have something like this and say it's separate from intrinsic spaciousness. That's, you know, completely absurd. Obviously so. And yet that's what we're trying to induce that. So it, for instance, if we think that having a cough will induce it, guess what? If we can pretend to have a cough, oh, me and my body's body, oh, my body has a cough. But we have these patterns of inducing have become so standardized in our mind that they show up as what we call genomes or genes, genomes, which are still just the habits of mind actually expressing, okay, as expressing as a body, as a pretense, as a pretense. Jesus says this in Dialogue on Awakening, that even in the case of genes, that too is just a mental projection, all a mental projection. And so we choose, he says, we choose these bodies that have the kind of pretending, pretense that we want, the mental patterns which are projected as genome sequences. And so we know when we were born, we actually plan and choose our lives very, very, very meticulously to have the kind of excuses, the patterns of excuses that we want, but it's a mental choice for the kind of mental habits we want of pretending, of pretending. But it seems to us like, oh, well, the bad genes are causing the problem. No, they're not causing the problem. So nothing is genetic, actually. Nothing is genetic. So if you think the world, if people, apologists really for the pharmaceutical companies are saying that we're about ready to enter into this great awakening of people who are going to awaken. Well, you know what? They would have to awaken into clear, absolute, clear, unequivocal recognition that genes don't do anything at all. Nothing is genetic. Nothing is body-based, and nothing is genetic at all. And how many are there of this world that are professing this right now in the world? I can't hear anyone saying this. So where's this? I may be the only one in the world who would say such a thing. I don't know. But most people say, well, the genes certainly have some effect. No, they have zero effect. They have zero effect. No effect. They're nothing. They're all mental too. They're all intrinsic spaciousness as well. Okay. But they just are reflections, our desire of our mental patterns. And they're really just mental patterns, actually. But we're trying to disguise that. And we're trying to make it seem, in order to induce, that the body's doing. Say, come on, abnormality. You know, look, we have this very abnormal situation for you. What are you waiting for? But it's really not an abnormal situation. But it's an illusion of an abnormal situation. And the genetics, genes are part of that illusion of an abnormal situation. They're not causative at all. Not causative. And so Jesus says this, I'll say it. And Jesus told me, he says, share my ideas. Share, share my ideas, and they'll grow in that way. So that's what I do. But, am I getting anywhere? Spitting into the ocean or something? What can I do? What can I do? I have to keep doing it. But it used to be that people, great many people, like Christian Science in the United States, for instance, a lot of people would have accepted this. A lot. And throughout history, a lot of people would have, we didn't used to be nearly as mentally ill as we are now. This is really the age of mental illness we're in right now, to an extraordinary extent. Thinking that, saying that it's both, some of both, is like the ultimate. And so I think a lot of those who think we're going to awaken to a great new age, everyone's, we're all going to awake, an awakened planet, believe that this, it's some of both is the answer. But that's the worst answer of all. Because, he's trying to say, well, we're separate from God. We're abnormal. We do have abnormality. We're separate from intrinsic spaciousness, but we can reunite it, reunite. That's the heart of delusion. Okay, that's the heart of arrogance. As Jesus says, you cannot make illusions true and then fix them, so to speak, reunite them with truth. It's impossible. And so you might say that's the heart of his teaching, is that's completely impossible. But the idea is that, well, we're all one, we're all these separate abnormalities, but we can reunite and become one again, is ludicrous. No, we've always been just one. There's only just one. It's never changed at all. That's the only truth there is. There is no other truth. There's no truth that some of re there was an absence of reality, but we've now but found a way to return it back, so it's not absent from reality. So reality had an absence, but we found a way to get the absence to come back. That is never the case. Never the case. Never will be the case. And really, in this world, that's the notion of spirituality that most in the world have, is that notion that somehow we've separated, there's been an absence from reality, but somehow we're healing that absence. And that is absolutely false, totally false. There's never been an absence of intrinsic spaciousness. What can leave intrinsic spaciousness? I mean, the fidget spinner, this, what does it occupy? Spaciousness. So if I'm spinning it here, how does that change its occupation of spaciousness? It doesn't change in the slightest bit. This way, it's still occupied 100% in spaciousness. That 100% inclusivity never changes depending on motion, direction, non-motion, non-direction, whatever there is just the one inclusivity. It never departs from that or deviates from it. It cannot. It's so obvious. It's so blinding. It's so obvious. It's blinding. And really, recognition is just to take the blinders off, and you get it, and you say, "Oh my gosh, that how it's so completely obvious and easy. How in the world could I possibly have not seen this before?" That's the reaction you'll have. How could I possibly have overlooked it? That's ridiculous idea. Well, it's absurd. We overlooked it because we wanted to see if we could change reality. That's why we overlooked it. So really, the realization of truth is just blindingly simple, blindingly obvious. And so we need to allow our attention to settle down into simplicity instead of complexity. And there's nothing more complex than trying to integrate truth and lies. It just seems like this unbelievable evolution and education and complexity. It's this unbelievable undertaking. We're trying to restore what was absent from intrinsicness, and it's so difficult. Well, it's difficult because it's impossible. It's difficult because it's absurd. It's difficult because it's overlooking the obvious truth that it never happened. So what we're doing is we're allowing our attention to settle down into this vast simplicity, which seems to be, the world is very hostile towards that. They don't understand that at all. They want complex, integral spirituality that weaves this very endless tapestry that seems to be somehow restoring something. But of course, that entire premise is the delusion, is the falsity. It's really supporting our arrogance that somehow we were able to induce an absence of intrinsicness. And we never have induced it at all. So the real teaching, which this is quite different than the spirituality you hear in the world. You know, you start to realize the more you settle down into simplicity, the more you're able to see, oh no, that's dualism being camouflaged by spirituality. When you see hear stuff about healing and restoring and reuniting and becoming and all this kind of stuff, you realize that's the false teaching that is, you know, supported by our desire to be greater than God. And it's a camouflage. And it's also our expectations continually pushing us back into that. When you get on the path to truth, you find your expectations keep pushing you back towards falsity. And even though you know it's false, they keep doing it. St. Paul said this. That's what he said. He said, wow, I know what truth is, but I keep going back to the false. You know, every day it's incredible. Because of what? Because of his expectations were pushing him that way. So he said, my practice, I must die daily, meaning die to what my expectations are expecting. And go through that. And it's like almost like dying because you don't know, you feel like I just don't know how to function. It's almost like when you feel like you're dead, it's almost like saying, well, I can't function. My functioning has stopped. When your expectations, you go beyond those, you feel kind of like this mosquito needs to get away. Like you've almost died, you know, really. You see, and for a while you feel like you've gone through a mini death. So this is really the path of the cross, is what Christians call it. The path of the cross is you die to your expectations every day. That's the real spiritual path. There's really no way around it, because we're so used to being brainwashed and trying to induce, very cleverly induce, an absence of intrinsicness, absence of reality, abnormality. That we expect that this is what we'll continue to do. And so when we stop doing that, we feel like something's really wrong with us. You know, it's kind of like we could feel like we're mentally ill. What happened? How come I'm not doing what I used to do? How come I'm not mentally ill anymore? That I must be mentally ill to not be mentally ill. And so there's this sort of absurdity that arises where you feel like, oh my gosh, maybe I'm mentally ill now because I chose not to be mentally ill. Now, if you look at it that way, of course, you have a catch-22, an impossible, absurdist type of situation, a bind, a double bind, right? If it's mentally ill to drop mental illness, then you're really stuck, right? So the emphasis to really to mental health therapy is this double bind. You have to be aware of this and realize it's can really trip you up. It can really trip you up. And you have to know how to handle this shock that you get after you basically decide, no, I'm mentally well. And I'm dropping my mental ill approach of mental illness, and that's so shocking. You have to read it as shock, temporary shock, because you're not sure how to function, and not as mental illness. You have to read it in the right way. If you read it as mental illness, you're going to panic, and you're going to go back then into mental illness and say, "Well, that's normal. I feel okay now because I feel normal. I'm meeting my expectations." But again, meeting expectations is if the expectations are that you'd be mentally ill, that's not mentally well health. It's mental illness. And so the long road back, it really is this struggle to not fall into this absurdist trap. And it's quite difficult. I've really been, you know, battling with this most of my life. And still do. So it's quite a difficult struggle, especially in a culture which is so supportive of mental illness and claiming that's normal. And if you deviate, you're mentally ill. In this world, if you deviate from being mentally ill, you're the one who's labeled mentally ill. And the rest of people are labeled, they're mentally healthy because they're doing what they expect to be doing, which is sticking with mental illness. So it's really upside down and backwards here. And no matter what I say, the double bind is still going to bite you, you know. And you have to become very, very determined and just keep working at it every day, and you get better and better and better and better at it. But still, it can get you if you're not careful. I almost got cut today by some sheet metal. I wasn't careful, and I was stupid. I was rushing. I was put in an awkward situation. I tried to move it, and it got in my face. And I think I avoided the worst of it. But I said, "Wow, how stupid!" Just because I was lazy in a hurry, and I didn't have the bounce I should have, you know. And so, there are times when we will slip back into absurdist position. That to drop mental illness is actually mental illness. Well, that's an absurdist position. It's actually temporary shock. So the emphasis we have is on this temporary shock and how to keep ourselves stable enough during this temporary shock so that we do not panic. That's really the entire key to success. Your entire key to success is to manage the shock, stabilize yourself enough so that you will not panic. And then when you don't panic, you will realize, oh, I'm not mentally ill. That didn't cause mental illness. But if you panic, you'll immediately say, oh yeah, I am mentally ill. Look how panicky I feel. And then you go rushing back into mental illness. But when you block the panic and you get through it, then you prove to yourself, hey, that was a lie. That dropping mental illness is mental illness is a lie, because I just did it, and I feel better now. I feel clearer now. And you'll realize the lie, and you'll see the trap for what it is. It's a false trap, and then you'll be more motivated to do it some more. So this is why we have to emphasize how to block panic, how to stabilize in the shock of dropping mental illness, so that you don't panic and misinterpret the panic as mental illness and then rush back to what you're familiar with, thinking that that's mental health, even though it's really the patterns of mental illness. So what we do is the wow practice. And the wow practice is how we stabilize in the shock. We meet our expectations. We say, when I drop mental illness, I expect to feel wow. That's what I expect to feel. And I am feeling it. And so we just tell ourselves, yeah, I'm feeling what I expect to feel, exactly what I expected. So my expectations are being met. So no reason to panic. I'm functioning perfectly. I'm mentally healthy because I had expectations, and my expectations were met accurately. Wow. Which is really saying I'm feeling shock. But we express shock in a very positive way. In a very positive way, and there's some, you know, will involved to cling to the wow, and not analyze it away. Okay. We start analyzing, we're starting to slip back into bad habits, but the wow is a mixture of elation and trepidation. You're elated because you took the step of dropping some mental illness. You dropped it, and you're elated that you had the courage to do this. But you're also kind of worried about how are you going to function in the future. So there's trepidation there too. So it's kind of a mixture of elation and trepidation. And so, but you say, well, I expect this. Wow. And it's kind of, you're kind of buzzed by the shock. And take it as a buzz, but you say, this is really positive. I'm going to enjoy this and not try to do anything about it. I'm not going to try to get rid of it. I'm not going to interpret it as something negative. I'm going to interpret it as something quite positive, but temporarily it has a negative tinge to it. There's some fear to it. But I'm not going to try to delve into the fear, because this is actually positive fear. It is nervousness because you just took a step towards freedom. That's all. A little bit of nervousness. So it's sort of like you would say positive fear. Nervousness about, oh my gosh, I'm not sure what's going to happen next. It's a little too exciting for me, you know. I'm jittery. It's just, you get the jitters. Don't interpret that negatively. We interpret it positively, like, wow. I had the jitters, wow. But we don't try to treat it in any other way except with patience. And we feel that we know this gradually is going to wear off. It's going to wear off, and I'm going to realize, hey, I'm still functioning. I can still eat. I can still move around. I can still do the basics of life. I can still do all that stuff. I may not be as sharp temporarily as sharp as I was before, but that's okay. So the path is one of being humble. And I've said, in my case, I chose a situation that turned out to be ideal for this path, in that I have a very lowly position in life, with no accolades in my life at all. No ex People don't expect anything from me. I don't have any degrees, no accolades. So they look at me with a blank. I said, I don't expect anything from him. So I can be in shock a lot of the time through dropping mental illness. And I can just be functioning in kind of a basic way. And people just think, well, that's what I am. I'm just kind of pretty much of a dullard. And when I'm not in shock so much, then they kind of think, "Wow, you must have, what's going on with him? He feels much better than normal." You know, it's like he must have, be having a great day. And I say, "Yeah, I'm having a great day," because usually I'm in shock from dropping mental illness. So to be lowly and humble, and also to not have any money, you're not tempted to try to spend your way out of the shock. Now, sometimes, it's tempting to go to Amazon and order something. I mean, that tends to do wonders, right? They're like, okay, something's coming for me. Something's in the mail. It's going to arrive in a few days. And that, seems to be a little bit helpful if you feel that something's coming in the mail for me, a package. But it doesn't really give us the skills we need. And you can go into get into debt that way. It becomes a ferocious habit, actually. So you have to be very, very wary of trying to buy your way out of it. If you don't have any money, that's very helpful. So you do the wow practice. Wow. I expect to feel this wow, and I'm feeling it. Great. Nothing wrong at all. Now, when I feel this wow, I kind of feel like I'm a bit of a dullard. Which is okay. But if you base your mental health on people thinking that you're some crackerjack, might freak you out. But in my case, I don't have any friends. I don't have anyone I associate with, so I don't have to battle those expectations. Because friends expect to see you like normal. If you're in shock, they're gonna say, "What's wrong? What's wrong? Here, have a drink. Here, let's get some coffee. Let's go to the coffee shop." They'll try to help you out of it. So a lot of times, friends are your worst enemies, actually. This is what I found. Your social friends are often your worst enemies because they want you to be the same. They want you to be normal. So they want to depend on you for their own stability. Like, I know I can count on you being the way that you always are. So they call you up. But where if you're in shock, they call you up and you're not the way that they expect you to be at all. And they say, "What's the heck's wrong with you? I mean, I want to count on you as a friend. I want you to be the same today and tomorrow. And otherwise, I can't count on you." So they'll try to get you out of that shock. But when you're on the spiritual path, that will result in panic. You'll actually, res and really the wheels come off badly. Badly, as they say, you'll find God in solitude. This is what they're talking about: is having no friends can often be the very best help of all. And I've certainly had that help my entire life. I really don't have. I've never really had any friends at all. Not because I'm antisocial, but because it's helpful for the spiritual path. I mean, I could get along in a wonderful way with everybody if I act the way they want me to act, but that precludes the spiritual path. So because we have to go through the way of the cross of this shock quite a bit, quite a bit. There's quite a bit of mental illness to leave behind, actually. A very strong, reinforced with massive amount of expectations and habits. And so to lead a life of a true pilgrim is oftentimes you won't have many friends. You may not have many friends, or kind of superficial friends, and you'll kind of feel like an outsider and a loner, and have a lot of solitude in your life, and you'll be maybe poor, a humble position in the world. All these super beneficial attributes, you may have those, and I certainly have had those to a tremendous extent. And so 99% of the time, if I want to do something, I say, "Oh, I can't. I don't have the money. There's no way I can do it. So I have to drop it." But boy, if I had money, of course I would be like everyone else, trying to buy my way out of panic. Say, I feel so dull. I feel so tired. I feel this, let me do this. Let me do this. I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. And that's not the spiritual path. It doesn't work. We have to gain confidence that that stepping away from mental illness, even though it produces temporary shock, doesn't lead us to panic. We can block the panic, and therefore we're not tempted to misinterpret it, this move towards mental health, as a move towards mental illness. That's a gross misinterpretation, and we have to be aware that we're blocking panic, we're in shock, and be aware of what we're doing. Otherwise, we'll lose track so easily here, so easily. And then you end up with a bunch of friends who expect you to be the life of the party and help them out with their shock or panic, whatever, and then they expect you to be that way. They have expectations of you, and that reinforced culture. This, hey, let's go watch a movie. Let's go out and have a drink. Let's go out and do this. That's really bad. So I don't have anybody calling me. I never have anyone call me. I don't have anyone mailing me. I don't have anyone calling me. I might as well be living in a cave, a hermit living in a cave. Nobody gets in touch with me ever. In terms of, let's go do something. Other than, you would say, immediate family. But even that is often precluded. Often precluded. I've turned down almost everything occasionally. Rarely I'll do something. I'll always regret it, of course. Because I'm always in state of shock. Or state of clarity. One of the two. Where I'm stepping out of mental illness. Or in the shock of having stepped out of it. Basically, constantly, all the time. It's one or the other. And then, working really diligently to block panic. And sometimes I don't block it so well. But that happens to everyone. Because if you're going really fast towards mental health, the backlash of shock can be very severe. And you may run into a little panic, and then later on you recognize that you went into panic, and you were not as functioning as clearly as you expected of yourself, but that happens to everyone. Happens to me, now and then, absolutely. I have to battle to prevent that. So that shouldn't deter anybody from continuing. That's very standard and very common, is you will go into a bit of panic now and then, and sometimes more than others, and then you will look back on that and say, wow, I really was a little bit going sideways there a little bit. Yeah, that's very standard that happens to us all. Absolutely it does. St. Paul saying, I'm going sideways. What's going on? I keep doing what's right, but I keep panicking, going sideways. That's the battle we all have. It's exactly the same battle. And none of us are so great at it that we're not going to have trouble with it. I mean, a lot of times I'm desperately trying to block panic desperately. It's like life and death. I say, oh my gosh, I'm going to slip back into mental illness if I don't do this. But I also put myself under a lot of pressure to step away from all mental illness and embrace mental health. And that really does produce dramatic backlashes. But, the further you go, the more you're motivated to go faster and the better you're able to block panic. So, it's just, it's pretty much the same old of a lot of work, a lot of focus. But the alternative is mental illness. And we can mask mental illness through drugs, and vast numbers of people are doing that on this planet right now. People don't even think twice before taking these powerful medications. And even if you're a billionaire, look at Tiger Woods, look what happened to him. It still gets you. A lot of these wealthy people are so messed up on drugs. They can afford any kind. Look at Michael Jackson. They can afford any drugs, right? They can afford everything. Everything in the medical care system they can afford and easily afford it. And they often become the most messed up of all. Me, I couldn't even afford medication if I was supposed to take it. I can't even afford it. So it's it's a moot point for me, really. I don't, why even bother thinking about something you can't afford? So blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor in spirit. Jesus sort of reinforced this a lot that, the ones who are really blessed in this world are the ones like in my situation and probably in your situation too. Those are the ones who are truly blessed because they can take the path that we've spoken of here very effectively without a lot of interference. Very low expectations of them. Nobody expecting to lean on them and expecting them to be normal in terms of functionality that so you can go through the low points of shock over and over and over and over again consistently. And this way you make very rapid progress. Even to the extent that you're able to start to really resonate with those who have perfect mental health. Like Jesus and the Dharma kings, they have perfect mental health. You more and more and more, you really start to feel and accept and just in a holistic way, beyond the words, you resonate with it. You resonate with it. You say that what they're saying is I feel it's really true. I really feel it's true. I'm really resonating with it, and beyond any explanation in words, it's deeper. My acceptance is deeper than words can explain. You start to feel that way. It's not an academic intellectual acceptance. It's way deeper than that. You really trust in it, and you just have this deep feeling of faith that this is true what they're saying. It is absolutely, that is, they're expressing mental health. I'm the one, the resistance comes from my own lack of mental health, not from any mixture of I'm right and they're partially wrong. No, they're 100% right. So more and more you feel that whatever troubles you have, the Dharma kings are 100% right, and you may be 98%, but you're still lacking that 2%. It's not, the 2% is not on them at all. Okay, it's not on them at all. You become more and more convinced of this. So, but sometimes you'll complain. I complain about Jesus. I complain to him a lot. You say, "Hey, Jesus, how come this?" But then I say, no, you're 100% right, and the troubles I'm having come from me. They don't come from you. You get back around to that. You do. You really do. But it's pretty. No, it pretty. Don't be surprised if you're complaining about the Dharma kings and say, "Nah, maybe they're 99%, but I think maybe 1% of what they're saying isn't right." You'll feel that way from time to time. But then you'll go back and say, "No. It's 100%. It's me. It's 99%. Maybe of the 1% wrong, and I got to work on that 1%." And you say, "Oh boy, more work, huh?" Yeah, more work. What a pain. I was very tired today. Very tired yesterday. Woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning again. I keep waking up at 3 in the morning, and then I'm, really tired in the afternoon. I sleep for an hour and a half, and that ruins my sleep schedule. What can I do? I'm so tired. It's rough right now. It's very rough right now because it's the healthcare system and industry throughout the world. It's a runaway train. It's a runaway freight train. It really is. It's just barreling down those tracks with no brakes at all. And unfortunately, I'm having to take care of some people and such that I find myself in the hospital and around medical situations a lot. And for me, I can just feel it and I'm aware of it. My God, the amount of money. The testing that they did. I mean, you go into a doctor and say, "Well, we'll do this test, this test, this test, this test." Massive amount of money for these tests, and we'll see what we'll get you on this drug, this drug, this drug. We'll do this surgery, 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 surgery. And you get into that, and it's like a black hole. It is a black hole. And some of the medical profession who are honest enough, and they feel that I'd listen to them, have expressed very clearly to me that they've told me the truth about it. And I remember that medical technician. God bless him. He found out that I had no surgeries, no medication, no none of that stuff, and he said, "Wow, you're very, very rare indeed." And he says, "Stay that way." He says, "Don't even start down this road." He says, "Because you'll never get out of it. You'll never get out of it." It's a slippery, slippery slope, he says. It's in it, and it'll kill you. You know, it's a death trap. And he's working in a hospital. And my doctor, which I never go to, but she says, you know, stay out of hospital, stay out of this thing, don't take drugs, stay away. If you can stay away, stay away. She doesn't even go to hospitals. She doesn't trust doctors herself. She's a doctor. She's an honest doctor. Old school, honest doctor. And she tells you, now, hospitals will kill you. Absolutely will kill you. The whole system will kill you. But what can she do? I mean, she's trying to help people. So I respect her. And people who do get sick come to her. And because they you know, believe that it comes from the body, you give them the help. That we're not saying those who believe shouldn't get the help that they believe will help them. We're not saying that. We're just saying what kind of mental discipline you need. You need to be a spiritual pilgrim to, if you want to get free of suffering, you have no choice but to be a pilgrim on this path that we're laying out for you very clearly here. They have no choice at all. So it's a runaway freight train, and that, at some point, consequences arise from that. And we get all these new superbugs that are resistant to antibiotics and all this stuff. I keep running into people telling me these horror stories, like their daughter got the flesh-eating bacteria and nothing could treat it. I'm in a hospital, and there's this woman there, and she had resistance to antibiotics and all that stuff, and she had this terrible infection. They couldn't do anything. It was horrible. She was just moaning in pain. And they're not all old people in the hospital. They're young people. They're people of all ages. You realize so many people. I mean, you go to the parking lot. Every parking lot of every healthcare facility is just jammed. Jammed. It didn't used to be that way. It's bizarre. People are constantly going to doctors. No wonder why I basically work just to pay health care for, dependents. And it's so expensive, and it's getting more and more and more expensive, and I don't use it at all. But everyone, the law is everyone has to have it. What about a Christian Science? What about those who know better? We have to have health care to subsidize those who are mentally ill. So the mentally healthy have to, agree and subsidize the mentally ill here. It's amazing. So everybody can feel good and normal about being mentally ill. It didn't used to be that way. It didn't used to be, if you're a Christian Scientist, you didn't have, health care. A lot of them didn't. And medical care was affordable. It used to be affordable. Yeah, you break a bone, you go to the doctor, they set the bone, pay the bill, it's fine. That's pretty much it, I mean, what else do you go to doctors for? If you get something really terminal, well, you die. Or you treat it mentally. And it goes into remission. Or, you go into some surgery and it's expensive and then you mortgage your home or something. That's not good. Friends help you out. Church helps you out. We handled our health care back in the day. A lot of people back then, a lot of them lived to a ripe old age, actually. They really did. And then some didn't. That is true. So people are being kept alive maybe longer now. But the amount of health care to keep them alive is just extraordinary. And so many people, they're terminal. They're really old, and they've got so many maladies, and they're just soaked for vast amounts of healthcare procedures, millions and millions of dollars. And this is happening with just across the board with elderly right now. Whereas in the past, you get some leukemia, and okay, I'm going to die. Okay, the body's going to die because that's the purpose I've given the body. So okay, the purpose is going to be fulfilled, and realize you're still spirit, still mind, and it's just all a pretense, and it's not going to work to induce abnormality, but you gave it a good try. And you had religious support for you passing over to the other side, and Spirit, God is there, and God is love, and God doesn't reject you because you got ill and died, and it's all okay. Wasn't so much trouble. Nowadays, it's like people, you get leukemia and you spend millions of dollars battling it, and you might live, another year maybe, but most of that year is in chemotherapy and you're suffering hideously, actually, and then you die. So I know healthcare is constantly brainwashing people about all the great successes of this and this and this, but really, they're incredibly biased, as you would expect. But just the overall cost of all these procedures and all this testing, etc., the vast, massive healthcare monster that we have, it's really the scariest monster in the world. I think it's causing more mental illness than anything, is the healthcare system we have. It would be a lot better if we had more psychiatrists and psychologists, actually. I'm very supportive of mental health therapists. Are you kidding? 100% supportive, except they have become very contaminated with the idea of integrating truth and lies. So they're teaching conflict, so they're really, a lot, some can cause a lot more mental illness by that, actually, and then right into the arms of pharmaceuticals because you're so sick, you're so messed up, you think, I gotta take some pills because the therapy isn't working. That's the trouble. So if we want really good mental health care, we have to turn to those who know the way, who know the way, actually. And so I'm hoping that there are those listening will become experts themselves in how to block panic. This is the way. It is to step out of mental illness, recognize the shock to your expectations, stabilize in the shock through convincing yourself that the wow is what you expect to experience, and you are expecting it, and it's here, and you're feeling it, so you're fine. Your expectations are being met. You don't panic. It blocks panic, and then gradually the shock wears off as you realize you can function fine, and you say, "There's no reason to panic. I'm okay now." It gradually subsides, and you get accommodated to the new set of expectations of that I can become mentally well, mentally healthy. You feel more and more that way, and that's okay. It's not mental illness, that's great. And then you're able to function fine. And then you go through the next jump step towards even greater mental health. This is the way. This is the way. There's no other way. There is no other way. And the sooner that we can all accept this is then the quicker we'll be into the new way of, there is no other way except this way. And this way will really liberate us into perfect mental health. Perfect mental health. Which is really should be the goal of any therapist is perfect mental health, which is to realize there can only be perfect mental health. There can't be the absence of it. And any belief that there's an absence of mental health is actually pretense, is pretending, is creative pretending. That's all that it is. And creative pretending has to come from the mind. Okay, it's perfect mental health, which is knowing that what that there's only intrinsicness. Okay. Any pretense has to come from that origin, right? Because if there's nothing else, how can it come from any other origin? So all pretense is spirit in intrinsicness, as intrinsicness, trying to induce non-intrinsicness, and yet totally failing, really. It's all failure from the beginning. So the real mental health experts are Jesus and the Dharma kings, those who have perfect mental health, and they tell us that there's only perfect mental health. There's really nothing other than that. We've never left that, but we do, since we've expected our pretense, some of it to be effective, we keep some pretense of mental illness, mental abnormality. But gradually we let it go. We let it go bit by bit by bit by bit, this pretending. But the pretending, of course, it has all our creativity behind it. So it seems very realistic, like we're very convincing to ourselves in our pretense. And our pretending goes very, very deep in many, many, many different ways. So you have to be patient, patient. And of course, mental health therapies can be very expensive. So I give it here for free to the whole world. You see, anyone can watch these videos for free, except for the internet connection. And so it's a very extraordinarily cheap mental health therapy here. And in the past, the only ones who could afford prolonged mental health therapy were the bourgeois and the aristocrats, and it was very expensive, of course. I mean, if you go twice a week for 30 years, you're going to pay a lot of money, right? But some of them did that. Some of them did that. And no doubt benefited from it. If their intention was to really go towards mental health, that kind of long-term effort definitely produces a lot of really good habits. But in today's world, I mean, basically, you see the psychiatrist once or twice. They determine what kind of medication you're on, and that's it. What you should take, and they say, okay, you can take Xanax or whatever, and somebody, and then they follow up. They follow you up. And, see, I'll see you in a couple months. See you in 6 months. How's the medication doing? It's doing, it's working out. Good, good, great. Stick with it. They adjust the dosage. They see to only to basically adjust the dosage. That's it. Because the everybody's so mentally ill, we don't have enough therapists, and it's too expensive for their time. Who can afford? I mean, they have to charge to sustain their themselves professionally. I mean, I just work at a lousy job, tough job, just so I can give free mental health therapy to the world. But I understand if you're a professional and this is your career, then you're going to need to charge for it. And so, but who can afford that? I don't know. It's expensive, and especially if you're really really suffering, you might not be able to work very well. You might be really sick. You can't afford to pay. So, in the past, that's why churches had strong communities. If you were really suffering, they would help with the bills and get the right counseling. And of course, back in the day, the pastors and the pastoral counselors and the priests, etc., would counsel you in mental health and turn to prayer, turn to God, trust in the grace of God to make your mind right. They used to call it casting out demons, cast out the evil spirits, cast out the mental afflictions that are causing the illness. It was a mental health approach. Religion really is really a mental health approach, which is why the quote unquote, the medical, the healthcare, world global healthcare is trying desperately to get rid of religion. It's the scapegoat, and they want to destroy it in the world, because it's turning, it turns us towards, mental health instead of mental illness. So they've done everything they can do to demonize it and continue. So, I'm doing the best I can do, free mental health therapy here, of extraordinary clarity and effectiveness. What else can I do, really? Now, if there was, billions of people watching, it'd be a different world. But there's not. If really you've had a billion viewers, that might change the world, because a billion people in the world learned how to block panic in the right way, okay, and understood the dynamic that we're talking about here. It would absolutely flip the script here, absolutely flip the script. But I get about, 44, which is great, but it's not going to flip the script. Now we know that Jesus and the apostles started out with just a few, and there was more, and gradually more and more and more. So, I guess Jesus must have faith in long-term treatment. But if you look at what's happened to the world, it didn't really carry the day, at least not at this point. So I don't know. Is there really? Are we really going to be able to turn it around in a short-term basis? If I look at culture and where people's mental health right now is atrocious. We think that back in Greco-Roman times, that their mental health was atrocious. Well, some were, but actually, the combination of the ancient Egyptian civilization that had been around so long and accumulated a lot of wisdom, the Greeks hadn't been around as long, and then the Romans not as long, but in the Persian Empire, and in the Indian Empire, Indian Vedic Empire, the ancient wisdom had been around a long, long, long time. They had the wisdom from ancient cultures that went back thousands of years, and even more than that in some cases, really. And the Jewish wisdom, the Jewish culture, Abrahamic cultures. So Jesus was not going into a situation where there was a total lack of wisdom at all. Alexandria, are you kidding? The Library of Alexandria? He went down to Alexandria to Egypt when he was a youth. That had the repository of the collective wisdom of the ages there, and scholars, so many scholars. It was not what we think of as just totally barbaric. Everyone was crazed and stuff. It was not like that. There sure was the decadent aristocracy in Rome at some point went crazy, but the Greco-Roman wisdom, and along with the Egyptian, and the ancient wisdoms of the ages, what was quite well known among the high scholars of the day. And that's why so many people took to Christianity and to prayer and to what Jesus was saying. They said, yeah, there is a way for us to be mentally well. The grace of God will help us do this. And so these people were not fools by any means. They absolutely were not. We look at the great philosophers of Greece, for instance. Look at Plato. I mean, was he a fool? No, 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 no. So there were quite a few back then. And there weren't as many people, right? So statistically, they may have had way more percentage of wise people back then than we do in this world right now. Much higher percentage. Nowadays, it's like finding a needle in a haystack, it seems like. It's unbelievable. So I don't know, I really don't know what the plans of Jesus and the Dharma Kings are at this point. Do they feel they can tip things in the right direction here at this point? Is that what they're after? Or do they feel that we need to establish some sort of home court advantage first so that we have much more confidence? I mean, those apostles had this unbelievable confidence and clarity that could just that cut through the culture in a most extraordinary way. Do we have that now? See, this is a question. I don't know. I'm not experiencing it. I feel very frightened in attempting to cut through culture now. It just seems like, and the people I've talked with experiencing the same thing. It's like, wow, it seems like we can't turn the tide at this point. But I don't know. The Dharma Kings know better than I if that's going to happen or not. The Holy Spirit knows if that will happen or not, if we can turn the tide here. But it's I get very nervous about it because I know what I've experienced here in this world. Every time I try to turn the tide, boy, do I get hammered. The hammers come out for the nails that's sticking up. Every hammer thinks that you're a nail that's sticking up, right? And there's a lot of hammers out there. Not that there weren't in Jesus' time as well, of course. But they were extraordinary back then. It was extraordinary times back then. We don't understand quite how auspicious it was. Now, so are these times auspicious, or is Jesus trying to rescue those of us who are willing, so and to give us an opportunity to stabilize and strengthen ourselves before we return at some more auspicious time? I don't know. I don't know. But the dependency on pharmaceuticals and the belief in pharmaceuticals, the belief in the body, I don't think it's ever been this strong in history, not even remotely close. And the flesh-based, creature-based attitudes here, I don't think has he ever been remotely close to this. We will see. Better see pretty quickly, really. I was in Vegas, found myself in a very unexpected situation in Las Vegas, like, the last place in the world I want to be. And I'm sitting there at the entrance of the Bellagio, and there's a massive amount of people going in and out, and it's just like an air more busy than busier than an airport. And we were waiting for someone. It was extraordinary. Someone was going to pick us up, and for some reason they got stalled out, and we were there for a long time waiting. And we were just, so I was just people watching the entire time, just people watching, and it was extraordinary. And I can honestly say that I did not feel or notice even a trace of any dharmic attitudes there. Not even a trace. Totally worldly, totally worldly, totally worldly, to an astonishing extent. People from all over the world were just flocking through there. And so it shocked me. It was stunning. It was quite stunning to see, just how far, we've fallen, and how arrogant and prideful the people are, how confident they are in that mental illness is the answer, and that they can treat the symptoms of it, and that will ultimately induce the absence of reality, absence of intrinsicness, and they will experience some glorious utopia from that, the triumph over reality. Meanwhile, they're in there gambling, and the creatureness, it affected me too. It affected me in my dreams. I said, "Wow, very." I get affected when I'm around that type of people. It gets your vibration gets into you if you're sensitive. Yeah, it's like contamination. Very, really, very worse than radioactivity, actually. So it's best to stay away from that type of situation, to say the least. But for some reason, God put me in that situation to just experience it and look at it. I experienced it, looked at it, and it's like, wow. People are very, very confident in mental illness right now. They think that the pharmaceuticals will treat it enough. They're gambling that they're going to win. So they say, "Well, I'm going to go all in with mental illness, but the pharmaceuticals will keep me well enough to function, and that I should be able to induce absence of intrinsicness and triumph over God." They believe that's how they're playing it. That's how most people in the world, that's how they're playing it. They think that they're going to win. Of course, they're going to lose. But don't try to tell them that. I mean, try to tell a gambler, for sure they're going to lose. They're not going to, they say, "You're bad luck. I mean, get out of here." Right? "You're giving me bad luck," is what they think. It's luck based instead of fact based. And that they're going to tip luck in their favor. And a lot of lady lucks there at the Bellagio going in and out. Every some, it seems like, every woman was dressed up like Lady Luck, says, I'm here, and needing companion to the money, the big money. They want Lady Luck with them, for sure. For sure. They say, no, being a creature, you're gonna win. I know you're gonna win. Being a creature is where it's at. We're gonna succeed." So there were some rather exotic creatures crawling around there, let me tell you. It was like I needed, put my hands over my eyes most of the time, actually. It was just astonishing how, how the get-ups that Lady Luck can employ. Vast varieties, never-ending varieties, but they all had this attitude, like, "Lady Luck's in the house, believe me. You can't lose with Lady Luck on your side, by your side." And I say, "No, you can only lose with Lady Luck by your side. You can only lose. You're a loser from the beginning." But they're trusting in pharmaceuticals. They really are. They really, really, and the health, overall health care, global health care, they're trusting in it. It's amazing. People say, "Yeah, that's all I got." Well, we'll go in and cut it out, cut it out, cut that out. I cut this out. Talk to a woman. She said, "Yeah, I had this is my 23rd surgery. 23rd surgery. This time it's cancer, but I feel fine. I feel fine. But I gotta make sure it doesn't come back. I gotta eat some healthy food. But she's I'm tough though. I'm tough. I could handle it. 23 surgeries. This is not uncommon at all. I mean, most people by the end of their lives, how many surgeries are they going to have? I have zero. Unless you call it a tooth got pulled. I guess maybe I just wanted to, not have too much pride in it, so I had a tooth pulled. But really, I look at it like zero surgeries. I like it to stay that way. And if I have an affliction, I say, great, it's the grace of God. It's helping me out. It's helping me out. It's keeping me humble. Keeping me humble. So the last thing you want to run into is Lady Luck, believe me. Because that's what really tilts you in the wrong direction. Because they're marketers, for the belief you can defeat God, you can triumph over God. And that, don't worry, mental illness is the answer. Just take these medications and you're going to win. So yeah, don't no, you're gonna win. You're gonna win. Just take this, take this, take this. Use this drug. Use this drug. If you're feeling mentally suffering from mental illness, that's okay. You got these drugs to help you with it. Just become really, really mentally ill, and then that will induce abnormality in reality. That's what Lady Luck is aiming for. No question about it. So they're truly sirens of mental illness. Absolutely, they are. And very scary, very scary. And so we may be going back to, well, we are going to the time of Lady Luck. You might call this era the era of Lady Luck. It's absolutely going that way in the most astonishing way. It's been that way before, but it's going to be more that way, most likely. I mean, the 70s, the 80s, the big hair days, the disco days. I mean, Lady Luck was in the house in a big way, and she's always in the house in a big way. But it may be in a much bigger way, right? Coming up right now, where it basically says, "Look, Lady Luck I'm assigned to you. You're my assignment, and you got no choice." Seriously, it feels like that. It feels like that. I'm getting that vibe. I'm picking up Holy Spirit saying, "Look at this, look at this, look at this." And it's almost like saying, "Look, you're my assignment, and I'm sticking to you like glue. I'm Lady Luck, and I'm going to bring you through. And we're going to really induce abnormality in reality and triumph over God. And I'm going to bring you luck to do this, you see." I'm supportive. I'm your support in your mental illness. Don't worry, you can be really mentally ill, but I'll support you. This is all I've gotten my whole life through from Lady Luck, actually. That's the whole thing. That's what they do. And of course, the other side, the high rollers, they demand. They say, "Hey, where's Lady Luck? Come on, where are you? Where are you? And here's the money. If here's the money. Here's all this grand lifestyle." And so it's a symbiotic sort of situation, actually. That it's a slippery slope both ways, isn't it? It's a sort of negative. Both sides collude together to work on this inducement effort. But if you don't want to do that inducement effort, and if you're a man especially, then Lady Luck is a very frightening thing indeed. Very frightening. You should be very frightened about it. Mental illness is a very frightening. It's frightening. It's fear itself. Really, I mean, you go down into a state of constant fear, and if you don't have an aversion to constant fear, then you really are counting on Lady Luck, aren't you? To triumph over God. Why else would you, be doing it? You're trying to mask it with all sorts of frantic activity, sex, drugs, rock and roll. With you try to mask it with Lady Luck. Come on, let's go disco. Are you kidding me? I mean, disco was heavy, heavy Lady Luck scene, wasn't it? Massive drug use in the disco era. Massive, rampant sexuality in the disco era. And rampant music, dance music, dancing music. It was just a club, 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 club scene. It was just unbelievable throughout the country. I mean, it started in New York, some of the big cities, but it was everywhere. So and Lady Luck reigned supreme. I think the number most of the big disco hits, like Donna Summer was huge, for instance. And you just listen to that music now, you say, oh my God, I mean, really? Did we actually live through that? How embarrassing, It's so embarrassing to think that we actually. Now, I wasn't in the disco at all, but I lived through all that, and I can hardly believe I, you revisit that those times, and you listen to the music and the styles and everything, and how aggressive and blatant Lady Luck was back then, and you just say, my God, what slime, I mean, how I even survive that? Well, didn't really. Paid a heavy, heavy price. So, Lady Luck is on the move, to say the least. If you want to see it, hang out at the Bellagio in Las Vegas, and that should scare you very severely, actually. Because Lady Luck is feeling very lucky right now. Okay, she's feeling very, very lucky right now. And she wants to share her luck with you. Now, Jesus knows this for sure. What's he going to do about it? Longchenpa knows it for sure. God bless Longchenpa. He is not forgotten at all. Okay? He's right here, right now, helping us out in a tremendous way. The Tibetan masters are helping us out in a Tibetan way. They know what's going on. And when Lady Luck gets feeling too lucky, we may get out of dodge. I don't know exactly, but his advice that I have picked up is refuge. Refuge. Solitude. Get away from Lady Luck. Don't even let Lady Luck find you, right? Because they feel like, you can't lose with them. And bringing you along to lucking into making reality abnormal is their entire purpose in existence. It's their sole purpose, they call it. Soul purpose. They're your soulmates. Oh, I'm your soulmate. Lady Luck is your soulmate. No such thing as a soulmate like that, actually. That's just another aspect of mental illness, pretense, something that we've tried to use. Don't worry, we can make reality abnormal if we just have to find our soulmate, and that will happen. There was a big thing back in the day about soulmates, and actually, it's still going on. And we're probably returning to that, and it's going to be worse than ever. The notion that you couldn't be saved, liberated, ascend, you can't ascend, all this stuff, unless you meet your soulmate and you do it together. Your twin flame thing. Jesus was asked about that in Dialogue on Awakening by Tom Carpenter. And he said, that's not true. It's not true. It's not true. So he just flat out, he explained it in the way he usually he explains everything, which is a wonderful way. But he gets to the final answer is, it's not so. It's not so. But when you got Lady Luck coming on and saying, hey, I'm your soulmate, there's just no doubt about it. It gets into a stalking sort of situation, really. And they're telling you, you can't be liberated and happy. Your happiness depends on being one with your soulmate. In other words, hanging out with Lady Luck or Mr. High Roller. And there's no truth to any of that. That's what you need to avoid, actually. I guess I don't look lucky, which is a big help. But the time may come when truly, as it has in the past. I mean, I'm a very unlucky looking person. But even so, Lady Luck has at times tried to seek me out and say, don't worry, you know, even though you're super unlucky, I'm so lucky that you can't lose with me. Right? You can't lose with me. So we're about to find out. Because it's all coalescing in a very big way. And when the world becomes more and more unstable, that's when Lady Luck becomes more and more powerful. When people just feel, wow, you know, we've just lost our way, and they're floundering, you know, and Lady Luck comes and says, don't worry, all you need is Lady Luck by your side, and you will succeed with your mental illness pretense. Triumph over God. So really, this is the age of Lady Luck, is the incredible ascendancy of Lady Luck. In the past, it wasn't nearly this way. You know, gambling was outlawed, most definitely. And the whole notion of Lady Luck was basically prohibited by religion, because they knew that that's the wrong way. And, you know, women were not allowed to get into that persona of Lady Luck. They were heavily discouraged against it. And therefore, men also were heavily disincentivized by it all, right? It was a huge disincentivization program to avoid that. Saying, you know, that you can't, don't try to luck your way past reality, you know, luck your way into the impossible. That just produces severe mental illness. To believe that you can luck your way into accomplishing the impossible, really, all that comes from that is really severe mental illness. And then it gets so bad that then what happens, Lady Luck deserts you. She goes, well, I'm going to use my luck on someone else. That's what happens. So you may think that Lady Luck is your ticket, but when you end up in the gutter with severe mental illness, where Lady Luck is nowhere to be found. She's with some other high roller, says, I think this one is going to be much more, I'm more beneficial to this one. You weren't my true soulmate, you know. It was just a step. But I found my true soulmate now. Now, Lady Luck disappears. And you're left to die in the gutter, is what happens. And then, if you're, you know, you really get real about it, you ask for help and the Holy Spirit shows up and he says, you don't need luck, you need facts and truth, and I'll give you those facts and truth, and you will recover your mental health. In fact, you really never lost it, you're just pretending that you lost it. But this pretense is, you have to defuse it all through your expectations, cause you to keep going back into wrong belief, really wrong perspective. So it's a tricky, tricky road to, you have to block the panic, and you learn how, and the Holy Spirit teaches you, eventually you learn how to block the panic better and better. And a lot of these Lady Lucks have studied the rhetoric of spirituality, so they say, don't worry, you believe in spiritual stuff, no problem, I do too, I'll make you even luckier, even better, you'll be really, really lucky now, because you know the goddess is really going to work for you, because you know these terms, you know these concepts, isn't that great, boy, you can't miss now, I'm really, really, you're really my soulmate now, you know, that kind of thing. So they school themselves in the rhetoric of it, which makes them all the more, you know, difficult to avoid, kind of, yeah. But it's not about the rhetoric, it's about the practice. It's about dedication to dying daily, like this, going past your expectations. That's what it's about. Not hanging out with all these people who expect you to be, you know, lucky for them, or to be a high roller or whatever, right? Find a way to triumph over God. you'll be in shock, and they say, "Hey, you don't seem so triumphal today. You're not really going to help my luck today." And we're not here to help anyone's luck. Nobody needs luck to be what they already are, which is perfect, right? We don't need luck to be what we already are. We need luck. We think we need luck to try to be different than what we are, except we can't be. So luck is really nothing at all. And ultimately, there isn't any luck at all. Everything is pre-planned by us at a deep level, and it's like the creativeness of the mind. Whatever takes place, we've chose that ahead of time to take place. Winning or losing, and gambling, etc. It's all predetermined by the mind, the one mind. Luck is not in play at all. Never is. There's never been even an iota of luck ever take place. Just as genes don't do anything, luck doesn't do anything. They're both void of any causativeness. So they're meaningless terms, really. So I'll probably get a backlash on this video. Every video I make, I've gotten a backlash. Every video I've made. So I'm always slogging through the backlash of what I say and my sharing here. But Jesus wants it to be shared. It's very difficult to do so, because you're stepping on the toes of the world. Stepping on the toes of Lady Luck and the high rollers. Not really stepping on their toes, just pointing out, as a mental health therapist, so to speak, you have to speak the truth. You have to. Your aim is to for us to drop the pretense of anything less than perfect mental health. Has to be. There can't be any other aim, because we're already perfect mental health. There's only pretense otherwise. So what other aim can there possibly be? Either to continue the pretense or drop it. There is no other option. None of the pretense can be real. Even when pretending to be perfect, have perfect mental health, even that pretense ultimately has to be dropped. So we cannot be other than what we are. So what choice do we have in the matter? We don't have any choice at all. So in sharing all this, I'm doing the best I can to share the ideas that I've been given from Jesus and the Dharma Kings, as asked by Jesus to do so. And he says, the more you share ideas, the stronger they get. So I pray that there's a lot of us in the world sharing these ideas. But what I have seen, we don't know how it ultimately, I don't know how ultimately it's going to go, and some are really doing their best, there's for sure. But it's tough to not fall into the trap of trying to accommodate, the notion of we can be lucky too, a little bit of luck, that kind of thing. It's difficult to, most try to kind of please both sides, kind of, to some extent, and you can't do that. You can't do that. Then you're just seeding more confusion, deeper confusion. You can't please both sides. You cannot please the side that believes it's possible to triumph over God. You cannot please that, because it's impossible. So there's nothing there to please. You have to say it's impossible. And what's impossible cannot be pleased. There's nothing there to please. It cannot be that there's a way to do the impossible. There's no way to do it. So you can't please those who want to find a way to do it, and those who realize there is no way to do it. You can't please them both. You're going to cause seed conflict. So really, we have to get off of that effort to please both. Really get off of it. Get away from it. That's what I'm trying to do here. But I know that just in trying to reach out to the world, it just seems to not resonate. Most people believe that no, we've got to somehow integrate it all. No, we don't have to integrate it. That will just make it worse. And that's part of the problem we have now, is this idea of we have to integrate it all. Truth and lies, is that really leads to severe mental illness, which then we think, well, we have to have lady luck, you know. So it's led to the ascendancy of lady luck culture is what we really have. I've called it the yoga girl culture in the past, but really lady luck is a better term for it, I think. I don't want to feel anyone who's doing yoga anyways is a put down, because it can be a very good habit. There's some positivity, you know, to all that. But most of them are really lady lucks. Lady luck doing the yoga. Okay. So they can present themselves as this seemingly, you know, very, very auspicious lady luck. Look how sleek and neat and beautiful and wonderful they are, and they have some spirituality too, and wow. So a lot of lady lucks have gone into training with all this kind of populist yoga stuff. That's why I call it, you know, yoga girl thing. But you know, the era of the lady luck is a, I think, a really apt way to put it, actually. Very apt way to put it. You could also say the yoga girl thing. There's no question that that's what's going on. You say the Dharma. Oh yeah, I'm really Dharmic. Yeah, I really love the Dharma. Yeah, Buddha. Oh yeah, Buddha's great. Yeah, and oh, what the? Oh, you know, I'm just kind of interested in that stuff too. Meaning, yeah, I can accommodate. The spirituality you have is not going to affect the luck I can bring you. You're still going to be able to triumph over God. Don't worry. I'm so lucky I can even accommodate your belief in God. You know, that's suit overconfidence, you know, and lady luck right now is this extremely overconfident. What I have seen in the world is the lady lucks of the world, and there are very many of those right now, are extraordinarily overconfident, projecting just this maniacal confidence, actually. It's right on the cusp of just breaking through. I mean, it has recently been poking through, and I just noticed some stuff, and I just kind of like, oh my gosh. Just a maniacal confidence that they have in that they can bring you know, the luck you need, that your mental illness is going to succeed. They can do it. They're maniacally confident, fanatically confident. They're fanatics, actually. Don't doubt this for a minute. It is very, very true that we live in a world now that's full of fanatics on the verge of this enormous eruption of overconfidence and fanaticism, that lady luck, and it's lady luck that is going to push it through for sure. We don't know what's going to spark it, but it's going to happen. At that point in time, head for the hills. Head for the hills, meaning take refuge. Now, I know Ananda Mayamma for a fact knows about this, and showed me this long ago, 20 years ago, you might say, this is what's going to happen, and she's going to make certain that I head for the hills. She's going to take me to the hills, in other words, make sure that I get refuge. So that was pointed out long ago. You know, now how this will play out, I don't know. And just have to trust in it, but this is the times that we live in, and we have to identify the times. And it's helpful, having gone through various other times of lady luck, where it burst out like a wildfire. It really did. Disco, are you kidding me? That just like was like a wildfire. It was unbelievable. I'm still in shock about it, at what happened. As there was the 60s. Lady luck back then was with the hippie chicks. And they, you know, basically said, guys, we're going to bring you know, the luck that you need. Don't worry. We got it all under control here. Yeah. Take this, take this, take this, take this. The drug, 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 drug. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. The 60s, then the 70s, late 70s, the disco, whole disco thing. And then the electronic music, you know, it's gone through various phases, but it's about ready to go through a very crazy face, very animalistic type of face. And the whole Wonder Woman might be the spark, the movie. I just saw a tiny flash of a trailer for it as I was leaving YouTube, as YouTube was promoting it. I was looking at my website, and there's just a real, I tried to avoid it, but there was just a little flash of, you know, of a preview of it. And just what I picked up from that, the expression, the whole ambience of how they're staging it. And I said, oh my gosh, you know, they're trying to spark it. They're trying to spark it. They're trying to spark the mania, the Lady Luck mania. You know, here's Wonder Woman. Don't worry. You can't help but be lucky. You have to succeed. Otherwise, you're lacking faith in Lady Luck, and you can't do that. It's not permitted anymore. Because if you do, you know, you're such a vile person, you should be crucified. That's what's coming. If you don't believe in Lady Luck, the belief is you should be crucified. I think Jesus knows a thing or two about that. That's really the attitude that is about ready to burst upon the world. Is a crucifying attitude. An inquisitional attitude. Who doesn't believe in Lady Luck? Let's find out who it is and let's crucify him. So we've built up to that. Built up. And Wonder Woman's about ready to light the bonfire of our vanities, you know. Yeah, the bonfire of the auto da fe, of the Inquisition, about ready to light that fire. And it's probably being lit throughout the world right now. So, hallelujah. Jesus is on the scene, no doubt about it. Ananda Maimah is on the scene. Longchenpa is on the scene. All the Dharma kings are very much aware of what's going on. And they will do what is necessary, whatever is necessary. We just have to keep blocking the panic, you know, keep blocking the panic, especially towards our great good fortune. What great good fortune is coming our way? As a matter of fact, well, I will see what to say later. But it is coming our way, and we have to be able to accept this great good fortune. Something really, really, really fortunate is coming our way. And of course, the opposition says, "But you'll never have the chance to get lucky. You won't realize the luck that you could have. You're turning your back on your luck." And we say, "There's no such thing as luck. And we don't need luck to be what we already are. That would be absurd, right? We're just accepting that we can't change what we are. That's all. We don't need luck for that. So we don't need to discover our destiny. We don't have any destiny." We can never change what we are. So in terms of that sort of destiny, it doesn't exist. It will never exist. And luck can't change that in the slightest bit. There's no such thing as luck. It's absurd to speak of luck if what we're speaking, the context we're speaking of, it's impossible that any change can take place. Then it's a meaningless term, isn't it? We're saying there's no effect possible. So why are we labeling the notion of an effect? We call it luck. That the whole idea, the meaning would be that there's some effect took place. But there's no effect that as far as changing what we are can ever take place. So we can never be lucky. We can never be unlucky. It's all meaningless. Now I have to wait another week for that golf club that I'm waiting for. It's really slow. I'm disappointed. But that means another week of working out. I did the trampoline first time in a while, and really, I'm so sore, my legs. I did a whole bunch of stuff I haven't done on before. And wow, I'm just kind of walking around like, you know, that 90-year-old guy was walking almost as good as I was. I was like, what's going on? But it does over, you know, doing it over and over, gradually, it gets really, really effective. I know that, so I'm paying the price, but, You can do trampoline work on a small trampoline if like if you do what I'm doing. Doing the edges, your toes, your heels, your edges, leaning on one leg, kind of leaning this way, leaning that way, all sorts of, unusual kind of postures and balance and weight distribution on the trampoline and speeds of it all, that really gets stability muscles that you don't normally get, and you think you might be in great shape, but if I can put you through a trampoline workout and the next day you'll hardly be able to walk. Very, very effective exercise, but you can overdo it if you're not careful. Just like this, I have no value exercise. The new way is a very effective, super effective spiritual practice, but don't overdo it. That's why I'm not didn't do a lot in this video, is don't overdo it. I did it this morning. I did every day. I do it, but I don't try to. I don't overdo. I realize this is powerful, very powerful, and we don't want to get, too much shock. Because then we start forgetting about the wow. I even went through a time where I forgot. I said, "How do I do the wow? Can you believe that?" Years and years and years of presenting it, and I forgot how to do it. And I had to kind of remember what it was all about. I had to remember it. It's amazing. I had to take definite steps and center and start thinking and considering and try to explain it. And I forgot. That's how the panic had got in to me. That's what's wrong with panic. You forget your wisdom. So you do not want to panic. You want to really work hard to avoid that. At the same time, you have to go qu quickly on the spiritual path. You have to quickly leave your mental illness behind. So that will definitely put you in shock. So you have to know how to block panic to have a successful spiritual path. You have to. You can't go too slow. You stall out. You might think, well, if we go so slow enough, there's no panic. Well, if you go that slow, I mean, there's no shock. Go so slow, there's no shock. If you go that slow, you're going to stall out. You won't succeed. You have to go very briskly on the path. Very briskly. Leave mental illness behind very briskly. And for sure, that will cause shock in you. And you have to then block the panic from that, for sure. So it's absolutely necessary to get skillful, be confident, gain your confidence in your own ability to do this. And there'll be times when you forget how to do it. I just forgot like a week or so. I forgot. It's kind of scary. But now I'm back on it. Not quite as good as I want to be, but and still it takes focus. You really have to focus on it. It's like, wow, okay, my expectations are being met perfectly. This is the sum total of everything I expect. It's exactly the ultimate in what I expect, and so I'm experiencing that now. So my functionality is just top notch, actually. I don't need to do stuff because this is the sum total of all doing. So it's better than doing anything. So what I'm doing is much more successful than any doing I could possibly do. It's just sitting here patiently is the ultimate success. So you sell it, market it to yourself that way, and then you're willing to be patient with it. You have to really market it to yourself. Very adamantly have faith in it that it works. Understand why it's necessary. Wow. I'm experiencing wow, great. The ultimate in functionality. Wow. At least from this perspective right now. We understand that we will go beyond that. But first, we have to get used to the ultimate at this place where we're at of still having these expectations is this is the ultimate in functionality. Wow. The whole soulmate twin flame thing was just a way of disguising Lady Luck and the high roller thing. It was just a way of camouflaging it, actually. But now it's coming out in the open. There's still a lot of attempts to camouflage it. Oh, you gotta have a Lady Luck riding by your side sort of thing, you know. And they put all sorts of different labels, but package it differently. It's the same thing. It's Lady Luck, plain and simple. And on Facebook, yeah, I was just getting massive inundations by Lady Lucks from every angle. That's why I got off of Facebook. And they're saying, "Here I am. Here's the Lady Luck you've been looking for." You say, "Obviously, you're looking for Lady Luck, and here I am." I'm saying, "Actually, no. I'm pointing out the opposite. I'm not looking for Lady Luck." But they don't believe that. Of course, they just arrogantly dismiss whatever you say. This is what I experienced. You know, you make it just crystal clear, and they say, "No. You know, oh, that's just, you know." It's like they just say, they just ignore it. They just ignore it. They say, "Well, you don't. You're out of your mind. You don't know what you're saying. You really do need Lady Luck. It's basically, you're crazy, and I'm here to change your luck on that." And, so I just said goodbye, Lady Luck. You know, I couldn't stop it. It was every day. You know, five new Lady Lucks show up. It's crazy.
Huh?
What's going on?
Okay.
So there you go.
A minute. Yeah. Okay. Does it need it?
Yeah, maybe that's time to end. But what a time, what a wonderful opportunity we have to see through all this, right? What a wonderful, great opportunity, and we are seeing right through it. So keep practicing the wow, and to the extent that you can, I have no value, devalue the I. Devalue the I, and you play with that the way you want to play with it. You know, I can't do anything. I have no value. I have this, I have this. I devalue it. Every time the I comes up, find a way to make an assertion of completely devaluating the I. And this is really will cause bring about very rapid progress towards mental health. Very great. That's it for this one. Wow.